We're starting on time and everything. Hello, everyone. Welcome to Introduction to SaltStack. Ignore the slide on there. But yes, it is the coolest toy, so you can pay attention to that part. Hi, I'm aurynn. I run a small company out of New Zealand called IR DevOps, largely because it's a lot of fun to work with infrastructure problems. And specifically, I really enjoy working with Salt. Today's session is going to go kind of, I'm going to talk for a little bit. And that's going to be while you're downloading all of the bits that you need for this to for you to follow along, because we're going to be setting up a small Salt network and then playing inside of that. So to do that, we're going to attempt to bring down the conference Wi-Fi. And in order to do that, we need to download about a gig and a half of VM images each. So the things you're going to need for this are Vagrant, which is current version 1.9.1, VirtualBox, current version, which is 5.1. And there is a bit.ly link, which is a GitHub link to the tutorial that we're going to be walking through. And then once you get all those pieces, you can do Vagrant up, which will start downloading a gig and a half of stuff. Well, the reason behind this is because it does do a lot of setup and prep work, or I have done all of this in advance so that you can download this and go Vagrant up and it will just work. Just work. Like everything ever does. So you should take a picture of this for the requirements because I want to go on with some other slides. So I'll give you a second to do that. And if you don't have your computer with you, don't worry, we'll be showing code on the screen and everything. Let me know when we're good to go.
There's power connections under every table. If anybody's just suddenly realized I need something.
50. Yeah, there's about 50 of you times 1.5 gigs. Yeah, we're going to make the network people a bit sad. Okay, let's move on. So, what is DevOps? No one knows. What else? What else do we think? What is DevOps?
Infrastructure as code.
Infrastructure as code.
CI.
CI, yeah. You in the back?
Development practices in an operations
manager.
Mm-hmm.
Yep. Yes. Very much so. For me, and for a lot of what we're about to talk about today, it is the base idea that software does not exist in isolation. Without a computer, your software, if you write software, or the dev software that they write, and you have to put up with, is no better than a pile of paper. It's just some random weird words written on paper without a computer to support it. But it doesn't exist in isolation. And the DevOps worldview is that because we're treating infrastructure as code, because we're going with strong communication practices, we treat the entire ecosystem that surrounds the program as the constellation. It's all a connected whole. Software doesn't exist in isolation. And we do this by thinking about some core principles. Isolation, consistency, and repeatability. Without isolating our systems, we cannot control variables. We cannot discover our root causes for failure. Without consistency, we can't control variables and discover root causes for failure. So it's all about control. Without repeatability, we cannot assert consistency. We cannot discover root causes for failure. You might notice I have a theme here. And a lot of this, like the example I have in my notes is, if you're setting up a machine, what happens when someone pulls the fire alarm? Where were you in that particular setup? Do you remember? Do you remember what you didn't do? Did the machine go down because the fire suppression kicked in and all the computers got turned off or turned into very expensive bricks? So Vagrant, which is fun, and what we're going to be using, is all about like the repeatable development environment. And if you were at the Docker intro yesterday, That's largely the same sort of stuff. Ensuring that you have a repeatable, easy to work with development environment. My job is delivering software. I'm not delivering software if I am not delivering an ecosystem in which my software works, that I can prove and test and reliably go back to when they say, hey, this thing broke. Because software does not exist in isolation. When we don't do this, it pushes, as a developer, the responsibility for the messes I've made onto ops, which is harmful. It breaks the DevOps mindset. It does not encourage communication. As a dev, it's me recognizing that my skills are less important, I'm considering that my skills are more important than ops skills, which is clearly not correct. We're trying to be a culture of collaboration. As a dev, in general, I think this because I'm not the one woken up at 3 in the morning when things break. So for me, on top of all of those other things, DevOps is a culture of responsibility. As a dev, I need to be shipping stuff that works, and I cannot prove it works if I'm not considering it that it does not exist in isolation. Most programming nowadays is network programming. Would we agree with that? Yes, no, maybe so. So this is where config management comes in, Docker comes in. It's the programming tools that let us treat our infrastructure as code, to let us reason about that entire constellation at once. There's lots of fun tools. There's 4 major ones. Puppet was kind of the first one that really took off after CF Engine. It kind of kickstarted the whole thing. Chef came after Puppet because a bunch of people thought, you know what, I'm tired of this Puppet thing, I'm gonna do it again. And then SaltStack happened because a bunch of people were like, I'm tired of this Chef and this Puppet thing, I'm gonna go do it again. And then Ansible happened, it was like, hey, this is cool. So we're good at this. But they're all about enforcing an end state. They're all about describing the system as we wish it to be at all times. So when we were writing this infrastructure as code, we're not writing the how to get there. We're just saying, I want that file to exist, or I want that package to exist, or I want that service to be running. We don't concern ourselves with, okay, well, this is a Red Hat machine, so I have to yum update, and no, is this an Ubuntu machine, and wait, which PPA am I installing from? This, a lot of that is abstracted away. We just say, this package at this time, go. And all of these major tools, and this is important, all of these tools have different ways they think about dependencies and ordering. So what do I mean by that? Well, say you're installing a web server, as we will be doing in a little bit, and you need to custom configure it. It doesn't make sense to drop the configuration file until you've installed the program. You can't write to a directory until it exists. So these are examples of dependency resolution that needs to happen. Now, in Chef and Ansible, this is treated sequentially. A file that happens before in Chef is guaranteed to run before one that happens after. So you set this up in your list of recipes. Make this directory, put this file there. Go on and go forth. Ansible works the same way. Puppet and Salt work a little bit differently, and this is why I find Salt so interesting. In file, the order is guaranteed top to bottom, but you can always reach back to something that happened previously. So, to take the, I wish I had better diagrams, or any at all. To take the Chef example, if I have file 1, file 2, file 3, I cannot reach from file 3 back to file 1. You can, but it's difficult. Whereas in Salt or Puppet, the expectation is you can. I can install a service later on that says, actually, I need you to go back and restart Nginx. And I don't have to think about that. I can just say, go find the Nginx service and restart it. Puppet has this power as well. This lets us do some fairly powerful things with Salt. We're not, unfortunately, going to have time to explore that today, but some fairly powerful things where we can build dependency graphs that cross systems. This is called orchestration. You may have bumped into it. Sadly, we don't get a chance to play with it. And that's what I find extremely interesting. It's all about persistent connections from client to server. There's some really fun things you can do with persistent connections. Stuff like, as I mentioned, native multi-server orchestration. Like Ansible, it uses the YAML plus Jinja model. Unlike Ansible, it does it in a much more messy fashion, which we'll not really touch on today. It can use Git repos as its direct backing store. That's cool. We're, again, not going to touch that. But the coolest feature is that it's not actually a configuration management system. I mean, hey, I've got a bunch of servers. Wouldn't it be cool if I could just run commands on all of them at once? So Salt, when we look at it, isn't a configuration management platform. It's a remote execution platform. Run commands on servers, return results, life goes on. So let's look at what that looks like. So I'm going to switch to a terminal, and we're going to see if the rest of you have managed to download everything yet. The answer may be no. How far are we on downloading things, by the way? Yes?
I don't want to download anything.
Right, okay. Yes, you came in late. I apologize.
I gave up, and I said it was going to take an hour and a half.
Okay, so it looks like we're not downloading things. Yes, you need these pieces, but it looks like we're not going to be able to do the thing. So I will just walk it through very slowly on the thing. It'll be cool.
Have you got any of them on USB already?
No. I mean, they're all exported, so we could just download. If we had a USB key, we could put them on and pass them around. I don't have one, so.
There is a different tutorial just on our laptops, like basic Salt?
Yeah, if you have a pre-configured Salt network, it was just to make it easy for everyone else. So these are the bits you need, but since an hour and a half, thanks, S3. Cool. Which way is this? There it is. Okay. Can we all read that? I can't see it.
Yes. Yep.
Yeah.
Okay. I can't even type. Hold on, I'm going to actually change this so I get a mirror. Please hold colors. There we go. Okay, on the slide I had this, which we can test. Okay, so what's just happened here? What do we think has happened here?
Magic.
Magic. We've got magic. Yes, yes it is. What else?
What's the Salt controller? Let's start from
here. Let's start from what's the Salt controller. Okay, who has used Puppet? Everyone. Okay, great. Who has used Chef? Who's used Ansible? Wow, you guys are awesome. So, Puppet and Chef and Ansible use a, no, Ansible doesn't. Puppet and Chef use a pull model. All of your edge nodes, generally you're going to be running a cron job that every n time goes and connects to the center and says, hey, do you have any work for me? Right? Ansible uses a push model. You log into the central server and you say, do the things. It SSHs out to all of the machines and runs the commands, right? Salt, as I mentioned earlier, keeps a persistent connection up. So it does the same sort of thing. It reaches out to all of the machines and pushes and does some stuff. Because it's got a full, so the controller is the central server. It is the thing that all of your edge nodes have connected into. They're keeping a persistent socket open to your control server. So when I just did this, salt test one, test upping, I've addressed the machine called test one, and I've said, Are you there? That's all I've done. Are you there? The connection is always established from node to controller. Okay? With me so far? Cool.
And what is test.ping?
Test.ping is... Let's dive into it. So how Salt is structured is that all of these things are classes, and these are methods in the class. So this is if you dig into the Salt stuff. In this case, there is a class of test things. Ping is one of them. All it's doing is saying, are you there? Is there a connection? Let me know if you're present. But we can do more things than that. We can do other fun things like run. Let's just test all of them. There should be two here. Let's see if there are. Yay, my network works. It's always a good sign.
Can I do these things on a local host?
What do you mean?
Well, I mean, like, I have Salt installed, right?
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
I didn't configure anything. Can I run commands locally? I can do it with Puppet, I can do it with Ansible.
You can, but we're not going to be going into that. Oh, yes. Please ask through the mic.
So the question is, like, can we just do things locally? Like, we can do with Puppet, we don't need any server for that. Like, we can do with Ansible. Local, we don't need any server. So can we unleash the power of Salt just locally?
Yes, but it is not going to work the same way as this, which is why we have the invagrant environment, so we can play with a functioning network. Unfortunately, the network is overwhelmed. Yay, we win, we broke the network.
So you can install Salt Master and Salt Minion on the same host, and there's a CA, local CA.
Please speak for the mic. As he was saying, you get to say.
Sorry. Yeah. You can install the Salt Minion and the Salt Master on the same host that uses a local CA to generate certificates, so you can do some testing on any single Linux machine if you want.
So I also said Salt was a remote execution platform, which...
Yeah, one more question.
Oh, did we? Sorry, I
missed that. Actually, I have another idea. Yes. You can use Salt to copy the file to your minion
mm-hmm.
or your remote server. Then you use Salt to execute it. So the script will run locally.
Yeah, that's what I would like to do, like, because I don't want to be sitting doing nothing. Ideally, I would just do both.
Yes. So. You're going to need a small network to play with, unfortunately. It's quite easy to set up, but it's going to require downloading things. If we had a USB key, I could get the VM images around.
I have a USB key.
Okay. My apologies that I wasn't able to get that online for you earlier. Where did I put them? Do, do, do. Beach ball. It'll probably help if we have multiple USBs going around, because it is a gig and a half. Thank you. the Vagrant SSH controller that will bring you into the controller. So as we talked about earlier, Salt is pull connected. So at this point, there's no passwords, so just go up to root. You should be able to run salt star test.ping, and you should get that response. It might hang, just keep rerunning it every now and then. It can take a little while for all the nodes to come up and connect properly. In theory, it should just work. So if you get this response, or a response with just one of them coming back, that's great. You now have a salt network running on your computer. The modern miracle of virtualization. But this is not the only thing you can do. So as I mentioned, that you should go and read this. Let me find the slide. We can also do other arbitrary things. We have this entire remote execution platform sitting right there. So let's run that. This is what we should get. What do we actually get if we run it? That's not going to work. Cool. So I just ran command.run on all of my machines. Or I just ran pwd because I can reach across the network. Yes?
Can you select machines based on something other than their name?
Yes. Yes, you can. There is an entire section that we're not covering today, but there is a large number of things that you can select machines based on. So stuff like, is it running Ubuntu? Is it running Red Hat? Is it running on an x86 processor or not? There's a broad range, but we're just addressing them by name directly today, just to make it a bit faster. Yes?
That's like factor the puppet?
Yes, it's called salt grains, and I don't remember how to pull the grain information off the top of my head. Yeah, I can't remember. So yes, we can run arbitrary commands on all of our machines at once. But that's not all we can do. For the network, we can also do all of these things. Each one of these corresponds to an execution module. Each one of these corresponds to something that we can do on the remote machine. So how about files? We can append to a file. We can find out where files are. That's not terribly useful. There was something in here, which was, these little colors. So one of them, let's read a file across the network. So there's a function that we can use called seekread. Seekread. So that's not really a very friendly name for it. A lot of what you'll notice when you're going through most of what's in this area is that these are not tools that are meant more or less to be directly used. You can directly use them. You can do some fairly interesting things with them directly. But this is kind of the underlying nuts and bolts area. It's fun to play with, but not necessarily the most commonly used thing. But you can still use it. So we can do salt test file.seek read. Let's read etc hosts. How do we? So we can just read arbitrary files over the network, just like that. And this is how much to read, whether or not to block. And this is why I say it's not necessarily the most friendly interface. It is the potential interface. It is what we can choose to do. But this is configuration management. We can reach across the servers. Well, what else is there in there? How about, thanks, Safari. How about Git? Can we manipulate Git across the network? The answer is yes. So what could we do? We could, where is it? We could just make up a repo that runs on the far machine. Why not? We can do that. Don't you do that. Welcome to Computer Anonymous. Cool. I just made a Git repo on a machine that is not this machine using Salt. That's pretty cool. Now, these are the sorts of things that we can do. So you should be looking through the execution modules and seeing other things that you could play with. What else looks interesting? What do we want to try? Install a package. Sure, it's like the default thing. Let's install a package. What package? Let's install. OK, let's install Apache. Bring up the package module. Is that it? No. Might be package util. And this is, again, where it gets a bit more complicated. Like, this is package support for Solaris. Not terribly useful for this Ubuntu machine. Apt package. That looks right.
Do-do-do.
We'll get to that. So we have package.install, so we can just install packages. I thought it was that, I just wanted to check. And then it hangs. If you notice, the example was just package.install. Yes, and we'll be going into what the masking there is.
Is there a velocity that you can tune to see what it's doing?
It will tell me what it's doing there. But it doesn't do it live. It does it once it's come back. So it is an asynchronous system.
There's no verbose.
I'm sorry? It's only after it comes back with that data. So yeah, it just told me what it's all installed to install Apache 2. Cool. That's pretty cool. What else? What else should we do?
Is it cool? Why don't you do that with SSH, right?
Yeah, you can do that with SSH.
Yeah, what's that?
We're not going to be going into the really exciting stuff today, unfortunately. I can describe it, but that's not terribly useful. Okay, so one of the things you can do with Salt that you can't do with SSH is configuration management across five machines at once. So this is one of the use cases that I've worked with a client is that we needed to set up a Galera cluster. So if you set up a Galera cluster, it's install one, install two, install three, then go back around the circle and connect them to each other. With Salt, you can do that natively. And by natively, I mean set it up so that MySQL installs on all of them at once and then walks the circle with each machine depending on each other before it comes back and says, yes, this thing is done. So it will halt execution on a machine A until machine B is done. And you can use that natively out of the box with Salt. Setting it up is a bit more complicated, which is why we're going to go into it today. But these are the sorts of things that Salt lets you do. Other things, because it is a full, and this is why you don't get live feedback, is because it is an asynchronous client-server connection. So you notice there is a long hang as the client node was doing something. That's because it's off doing something. It's logging all of that, its output locally and buffering it. So eventually, if it had been a really long-running task, my controller would have said, yeah, actually, it's going to come back later. And it would have come back later. I would have gotten an identifier that I would have been able to query and said to see whether or not it was done. OK, cool. I have an asynchronous distributed network now. And because of that, because of that two-way bus, I know there is in the underpinnings a mechanism for doing distributed jobs. Right? That's how this has to work. It's a distributed execution platform. There must be a distributed job system. And there is. And Salt exposes that. So the cool thing I can do is I can write a program that lives on my edge nodes that speaks to Salt and says, hey, an event has happened, which ripples up to the Salt controller, which can then act on that and set off other things. So my edge node can say, actually, I'm shutting down. And the Salt master can pick that up and say, actually, I need to pull that machine out of rotation. You can do that automatically without something else that moderates that. Salt can do that by itself out of the box. It's fairly easy to set up. You can have arbitrary programs that connect to the Salt network interfaces and do these things. Salt can just be your transport. It doesn't have to be running through Salt directly. That's why it's cooler than SSH. Oh, and you can do most of this over SSH with Salt. It supports it. Yes?
Can you use it to build consensus-based actions in a group so that, for instance, if you have a group of servers...
Could we get the mic up here, please?
Sorry. I can just speak louder.
It's so we can get it on the stream.
Sorry for my voice. So can you use Salt to build essentially a consensus-based activity? For instance, if you have a set of servers being managed by Salt that are providing like web services, could you have one say, I need to shut down, and the consensus be, oh, you can't shut down because our load is too high. Can you wait while we bring up another server, and then you can go down?
Yes, but then you're getting into all of the normal problems of distributed programming.
Yeah, no, I understand. But I mean, you do have the ability to like have that correlation going on. You do have the ability to have shared information.
Yes.
This is probably not where you're going today. So.
No, we were just going with a very simple example of installing a web server and installing a little application and just getting
system. That's great. I was just trying to think of something that doesn't really work very well with SSH in back and forth. Mm.
But yes, you can. You can send a notification to a system and say, I'm going to shut down, and have another notification come back and say, actually, not yet. Salt will let you do that.
OK, cool. Thanks.
Out of the box.
Hi. Question. Can you talk about how the access control works here?
The access control. So this is something that wouldn't have been directly visible with the Vagrant environment as we would have brought it up. But how Salt manages access is. So when a minion connects for the very first time, it generates a private public key pair. It uploads its public key to the master and says, hi, I exist. Please let me in. The master then halts it. It will not let it connect until an administrator comes in and says, actually, yes, you get to connect to me. And those keys get stored here. And they're named against. Yeah, public keys. And they're named against like the name of the machine that's going to exist on your network. And so in our case, we have two machines, test one and test two. They are named test one and test two at the Salt level, as well as the server's host name. The alternative way of authenticating your machines, or in terms of getting them connected to the network, is you pre-generate the keys, put the public key on the master, put the public and private on the minion node, and go from there. But it's all managed over public key crypto. Oh, we should get the mic over there. Thanks, computer.
Thanks for that. I was actually also interested in how the authentication works when you run the Salt command as a user. And then later, something runs on your nodes. So which user is it running as on the nodes? And how does it work out that I have the permission to do that?
It runs as root on all the nodes. It kind of has to because of the amount of control it needs to have on the system. Or did that not quite answer your question?
So what limits the ability of individual users to send commands to the master?
To send commands to the master?
Yeah.
Commands are never sent to the master as the sort of commands that I was showing a little while ago. What happens is you send a network packet or a JSON blob that has a key tag and a body, which is a JSON blob. That key tag is matched on the master side and says, do I know what this is? Can I use this? Then the master has made the decision that it will continue off and do that thing. And that could be run some salt code. That could be hand off to an external program to do something. But at the master level, you've always predefined what those keys are and what the acceptable data is going to be. There was someone at the back.
I was just following up on the node enrollment thing. Mm-hmm. So it does it actually use like a CA like Puppet does, or?
I believe it's self-signed.
Right. Okay. Thanks.
There's a question over here, please. So many things, which is why I tried to have a working out of the box environment. Try restarting the minions.
Yeah.
That's about all you can do without me coming over there. I can't hear you. I'm sorry. So that's all just looking at the execution modules. We can look directly at the next level up, which is the states. So this is much more similar to a chef recipe or a puppet manifest or an Ansible play. This is the level in which we are doing actual configuration management. And this will look different because it is all of these, the execution modules, these are imperative. These are how do I do the thing? What order do I do the thing? Effectively, you're making function calls. So you have to know to do all of the if statements and branching and logic to use these tools properly. At the higher level, the state layer, it is declarative, exactly like Puppet. You declare an end state. You say, I want this file to exist. I want this directory to exist. I want this package to be installed. And it takes care of it for you using the underlying execution modules. And that is here. No, wait, no, that's not it. Here, the list of salt states. So this is going to be the other major piece of documentation that you should be looking at when you're writing salt. This is everything you can do at the state level, at the level of the files that we're about to be writing that are salt words. Salt configuration management, sorry. So let's bring that up. Go Gadget Network. Aren't computers great? Okay, that doesn't look like it's loading for right now. So let me bring up an example of what that kind of looks like. And you can all follow along with this. Git branch. So in your salt tutorial repo, you will have all of these branches. This is what we're going to go through. This is building up a complete salt environment that will deploy stuff onto the test one and test two nodes. So the very first level, we just kind of need to install Nginx. So what this has done is created a new directory, which is this serve directory. And we've declared two files within the salt subdirectory. Can you read that? I'm not sure if it's big enough. So there's two new files, nginx and top. So how salt works, how does it figure out what to do and where? That is the top file. The name of why it's called top is, I don't know. I haven't found that documentation yet. There's probably a reason. So this is a three-tier layer. This is the environment, the machine, the state file. Environment, we're only going to use base, which is like the default environment you get, but it does give you the ability to segment your environments. So the examples that give are a QA environment, a development environment, a production environment, each one which will have different state files applied to them with different configuration applied to them as well. This test one, in this case, is a the exact name that doesn't have to be. We're not going to look at the level of selector detail that you have, but we can get into the same level of detail with factor to subset what we're applying at any given time to a fairly high resolution. So in this case, I've declared in the base environment, the machine named test one should have nginx installed. Well, that's not really nginx. That's a file on disk named nginx.sls. All salt state files are called .sls. And that looks like this. So we saw package.installed earlier. This is a YAML file. It's just straight up YAML syntax. We have the name of the package we want installed and the command to run it. This will come in one of two ways. This will look like this, or like that. Those are the two ways you will see it happening. No, that's not quite right. So the first one, this looks a lot like Puppet, where the name of the block will occasionally need to be passed in to name the resource. I'm getting the terming wrong. I haven't used Puppet in a while, I'm sorry. So in this case, in the top case, nginx is the name of the declaration as well as the name of the package we want installed. In the second one, the name of the declaration is nginx-package, so we'll need to pass to package.installed the name of the package that we want, right? This is because these names are locally unique. So if I needed to do something else later, like start the nginx service, I wouldn't be able to call it nginx, even though I would be able to use the same sort of structure like this, and we'll see this later. So just install nginx. That's all we're doing. This is the apply function when you're running a salt network. Connect to all the machines, apply the appropriate states. This will always default to running what's called a high state. A high state goes off and queries the top file and says, what should I do? Give me the list of things I should apply, and applies them. So if I do that, it will tell me that test two is not available, which is not useful. So that's telling me I haven't declared anything for test two, which is true. And this is telling me that on test one, nginx is already installed. Cool. We are now doing configuration management with salt. Cool, so we want to install like a full web app. We want to make two machines doing something similar. So let's get a web app involved. And fortunately, I have written the world's simplest web app, which is extremely useful for these sorts of scenarios. So if you check out 2-top, you'll get to see the configuration for that. So let's jump back here. So I've added a new SLS called web app. You can pull that up in your browser, the world's simplest web app. It is a small Python script that just will reply, hello. It's really simple, really easy. So in this case, let's go look at the Git. No, that's still loading. That's not good. So this probably won't work because my network does not appear to be working. Yes?
Yeah, off on dance.
So let's look at the git.latest state. So earlier we used git.init at the command line level, but if we're looking here at the state level, there is no init function. This is because initializing a repo is not a declarative action, it is an imperative action. It is a thing that you cannot guarantee, you cannot make a guarantee about it, like this git repo has been initialized. But you can say, give me the latest version of this repo. And so we can see all of these variables that we can pass in. But really, we don't need most of that. We just need like the bare bones, where the repo is, where we want to put it. Which is that? What the repo is, where we want to put it. We also modified the top file to say, OK, on test two, I want you to check out the web app. And if we run that, we get an indication that A, Nginx is already installed, everything's fine, no changes. B, we checked out the latest Git. And it doesn't have to be latest. Dot latest is a word deceptive. You can pass in a revision string, and I highly recommend that you always do pass in a revision string. That will be either a branch or a SHA. What I'm doing with unqualified latest? Yeah, don't do that. Bad practice, bad aurynn. OK, cool. So we've checked it out on the machine, but it's obviously not running. Nginx is probably running because Ubuntu is helpful like that, but that doesn't help us. It doesn't help us do our proxying fun. And in fact, we can test that .11 is test 2. And yeah, there's nothing running. Oh, it is running. That's helpful. That's not good. OK, so what's that? So the next was going to be ensuring that we have base level package support installed. I didn't clean up my demo environment properly, but what we should have experienced was that Git was not installed on the machines. So that would have failed, would have been a failed run. So in this case, we've added a base.sls file and added that to the top with a star. So we're selecting all of our machines should always run the base command. Always do this thing, right? So that will apply to all of the machines at once. Use star sparingly, because if you've got 100 machines, that is actually going to be all of them. Nothing else changed in that particular branch. Everything is just installing normally. The next level is, well, we need to configure Nginx so that the branch name is 4-top, et cetera. These are going in order. The next level is we have to configure Nginx. So let's just drop in a simple, extremely simple Nginx configuration. So we know 10.11 is test 2, because I told you. We know it's running on port 8080 because that's where you put things. And we just want it to serve on location slash. But that doesn't help us. It's just a file living in salt. How do we get it onto our machines? So I've also changed the nginx.sls file, and you should load this up on your machines. This is much more complicated than it was a moment ago. In this case, we're still installing nginx, but excuse me, we're also dropping the configuration file in. And so this one's new, file.managed. It does exactly what you say, what you would think. It manages the file on disk. This will do a SHA-1 comparison of what is on disk compared to what it thinks it should be. So we'll always ensure that what you think it should be is what it is. This, the SALT protocol, is the SALT file server. Any file that you've put within this tree is available on all of the nodes that the same that the SLS file would be available to. So in our case, we've said that test one should have access to nginx, so it will have access to that file. I think it's actually keyed on environment. So test two would also have access to that file. So please be careful with that. That is one of the security leaks, is that it can be difficult to see what is available where, and you should check. But the other thing we've done is we've started to look at the dependency ordering. So I did mention earlier that this is going to happen in file order. So it will try to install nginx, it will try to create the configuration, and it will try to restart the service. So that would succeed normally. But, and this is one of the things I've always loved about Puppet, is that we can always and should always be asserting strong dependency ordering. Always assert what happens when and what should depend on what. So in this case, this file doesn't make sense to do anything with until nginx is installed, because the installation sets up the right directories. And we could make the directories ourselves, and we could tell apt to not try to overwrite configuration files to do the right thing. But it's easiest to just say, actually, once nginx is installed, this is OK. And then, because Ubuntu helpfully starts the service for us when it starts up, we want to restart it. The watch command, I forget the name of the command in Puppet, but it's the same thing. When notify, yes, that is the notify command. Yes, and you can do it both ways. At this point, I can say watch underscore in. And this is where the graph, similarly to Puppet, becomes obvious. Later on, I could have said, go back to the nginx service and let it know that I want it to be notified when I do stuff. In this case, we're just monitoring the other things. We're subscribing to them. And the other thing that we've noticed is this, which isn't what this is. It's different, right? OK, that's weird. What's going on? And this is an important little gotcha that tripped me up several times. So as I talked about earlier, this is the name of the declaration. And this is what it's trying to do. But similarly to the execution modules, this is a class, or package is the class, and installed is the function. So what we've bound under the covers is a tuple of name and class, comma, function to call. So this is the block of what this thing is. Nginx is a package that we will happen to be calling installed on later. So down here, when we say, I want to refer to the package named nginx, I don't need to refer to what I asked it to do earlier, the function call installed. I just need to refer to its class of package. Could we get the mic up here? yeah, just here, sorry. Thank you.
So could you remove the first two lines completely, and would it just check the operating system package exists, or is it checking a reference to this config?
It is checking a reference to the configuration. Nginx here is referring to the name of the salt declaration Nginx. So if I changed this to Nginx package, like we had the example earlier, like that, I would need to change this to Nginx-package because I am referring to the internal name, not to the system level package, right? Yep, cool. Okay, so if we run that, again, I didn't clean up my demo environment properly. You should get slightly different output, but the same basic idea. Our packages are all installed, Git runs. The second one, Git actually succeeds because Git is now installed, and the configuration file is dropped properly, and Nginx is reinstalled properly, or restarted properly, rather. All good? Cool. Carrying onwards. But at this point, Nginx is not going to work. You can hit it on port 80. It's going to be 192.168.10.10. On port 80, it won't work. And that's because we haven't actually started up the web app on the other machine yet. So we need to do that. So what's changed? The Git branch was 5 dash, et cetera. So what's changed? We've added a new file. I discovered earlier this afternoon, much to my surprise, that these Xenial boxes are actually running upstart. And I thought Xenial was when they'd switched fully to systemd. So that was surprising. So it's just your standard, the standard upstart script, nothing major, nothing surprising. The top file, nothing's changed. At the web app, we've added some more files. So we're not just pulling from Git anymore. We're doing the same basic thing. We're dropping a file onto disk at /etc/webapp/conf, and we're starting it up. Again, we're requiring and watching on it to ensure that that happens first, even though it is in file order and even though it will run in sequential order. Always, always establish your dependencies strongly. And this one, I did this in the other one too, in Nginx. There is an interesting little feature that that Salt gives you, similarly to Puppet, where you can name the declaration, and that gets passed in as the name argument. And you're seeing in some places I'm passing a name argument, or I'm not. In this case, I'm not, and in this case, I am. This declaration name is transparently passed through as the name argument if you have not provided a secondary name argument. So I could, in theory, I could completely and workably do that instead. And that would work fine. But it makes it really hard to type it out later in require statements and watch statements just to ensure that it's working. So a lot of times I will give it a much more easily worked with name. For files, it actually makes a lot of sense to use the file name as the name of the declaration because later on you can easily see I'm referring to this file at this path. It makes it quite easy to see what's going on and where. Does that make sense? Yes, no, maybe so? Clearly it must. Do we have a question in the middle, please?
Is that possible to pull a branch from Git?
Yes. So we didn't look at that, but let's bring up the documentation for Git. So yes, there is a branch argument here, it defaults to head, whatever's latest. But we would do, I don't actually remember what any of the branches on that repo were called, but you would add a branch name right there, right? So that would work. So we run this. And it tells us it's dropping off the file and ensuring it's present, and that it has restarted the web service. So at this point, if you've run this in a couple of seconds when it comes back, you will be able to do that and get a hello because I'm not returning a carriage return with it. But yes, so that's words. You will. This we're now actually at a point where we've deployed a small web app with Salt. But it's all hard-coded. We're not actually setting anywhere what any of these values should be. Like, where are we setting the port? We're not. And I haven't extended this out to doing it at the web app level, but I'm going to show you how we would do that at the Nginx level. And this is getting into the where it starts looking kind of complicated. Or messy, rather, because Jinja and YAML integration doesn't play nicely, it turns out. Come on. OK. At this point, this is the Nginx config file. And I've changed the port declaration, which was 8080, to brackets port. This is a Jinja template tag. Who's worked with Django templates or Jinja templates or Mustache or anything like that? Yep, this is going to be exactly the same as working with those things, with all of the same problems and flaws and weirdnesses. Everything you've experienced, you get again. At the Nginx side, at the file declaration, it gets slightly different. This new section has been added. So context, this is the dictionary where you're passing into the renderer for that file. Say, this is what this is the dict. So we're declaring the port variable, obviously. Looking back at Nginx, port, yep, that's all going to work fine. This, we're asking Salt, what is this? So the Salt pillar is the major data store structure within Salt. This is exactly the same as Hiera in Puppet. I forget what Ansible's is called, or the Chef Data Vault. This is a tree structure that you can put arbitrary information into. Not only that, it's extremely easy to hook it up to arbitrary data stores. Anything that can return a dictionary, a nested tree dictionary, you can hook up easily to Salt. In this case, we're just going to use files on disk. This is the simplest and easiest way forward. Similarly to Salt's states having a top.sls file, the Salt pillar also has a top.sls file with the exact same structure. We have our environment, we have the machines we want to address, and we have the state file that we want to add. In this case, we have a state file named base. So at the same level of the directory, we need base.sls. And then we just have one entry, which is web app, which has one key, which is port. This is a standard YAML file. And indeed, if we parsed it with YAML, it would come up with that. So we're setting port 8080. Cool. Coming back here, we're asking the system for web app key port. It will give us 8080. And we can test that by actually delete the file, so it will do something. Thanks, Beckleys. So when we run the apply here, what we'll see is it renders it out through, and it should have shown me. So it renders it out through, and we end up with port 8080 in there. Now, what we're starting to see here in the SLS file for Nginx is where it starts to get a bit messy. Now, if you know Ansible at all, you know at the key level in your play file, that's where these double braces will start coming up. That's where YAML will get rendered by Jinja, right? Salt lets you go further than that. Salt, each of these SLS files are parsed directly by Jinja first. So you can have everything that you could do at a template level at the SLS level, which means you can do fun stuff like big if blocks. And this clearly won't work, but as an example, that level of blocking within the YAML files is possible. So you can query off into the pillar file, into the pillar state, the data tree, and say, should I even be doing stuff on this machine? You can query the salt grains, which is the factor, which is all of the stuff about the machines. And you can say, is this an Ubuntu machine? Well, if so, I need to do these things. Is this a Red Hat machine? I need to do these things. And this is the kind of the major place where salt falls down, is because this will tend to make fairly messy SLS files. It can be managed, but it does become a bit harder to make clean files as compared to, say, Puppet or Chef or Ansible. Fortunately, that's kind of, from here, it's getting into just repeating the same things, moving, adding the port information to the web app and going on from there. But this is like the basics of having a full salt environment. At this point, we have a small test environment that sets up a web app and makes it work. If you run salt, if you destroy all of those machines and bring them up again, and just run salt apply, it will come back every time. Thanks, Vagrant. Yeah, thank you. Any questions? Yes. You, here in the front. Thank you.
Thanks for the presentation. So in Puppet, there is a thing called a... There is a Puppet, there in the Puppet, there is a thing that's called a virtual resource.
Mm-hmm.
Which is not rendered until you render like the virtual resource type. What I'm talking about, you know what I'm talking about?
I think so. It's been several years since I used Puppet.
Okay, so imagine I'm doing the application like that, and on the side I also want to configure my firewall.
Mm-hmm.
But not all machines are configured with firewall at all. So I will have virtual resources attached to my web application that will say open port 8080.
Mm-hmm.
For incoming connections. But on some of the machines that I deployed to, I do run IP tables and I do configure it. On some others, I don't.
Yep.
So at the machine level, then I would say, okay, now for these types of machines, you do render firewall rules. And it takes and converts all these virtual resources, mm-hmm. virtual firewall rules into the real ones. And on the others that don't use firewall, they just don't apply. So is there something like that in Salt?
There's two ways I would approach doing that. One of them would be at the top file level that I mentioned earlier. So I would have one class of machine, which is called web app. And I would just have that as star. And then another class of machine in here, which has a slightly different selector. We didn't go into the depth of available selectors, unfortunately. But I would have a different selector there that also added the IP tables controls. Or the alternative is having it in one of these files with an if guard to say, because it will not get rendered out for those machines, it will just be stripped out. So you can assume that all of these are effectively virtual resources unless Jinja has rendered it. So you can mask them out if you wish. I'm not sure if that made sense. Okay.
Thanks, Aurynn. It's another one of those sort of how would you do this Puppet thing mm-hmm. in Salt questions. And it's one thing in Puppet is like the custom types. So say you had like a whole lot of these reverse proxies that you wanted to set up, you might write a reverse proxy type and then just supply the little bits of data to them and say, okay, make them like this. Can you do that sort of flexible thing and write your own types?
You can both write your own classes like this, but you the better or the more common way of approaching that that I've seen is that one of the powers that Jinja gives you is import. So you can import other SLS files into your SLS file, and that would bring in a function name because Jinja gives you function names because it's nearly a complete programming language that would define that block of YAML. You would then pass in arguments into it via the pillar, and it would render out.
Is this also how you like would go about reusing other people's code if they've written a really good reverse proxy thing?
Yes. This is, and this is, there is a big Git repo that whose name I've forgotten, unfortunately, that that SaltStack Inc. maintains that has a whole bunch of things like that for you. Yes, exactly like the standard library. There's nothing as comprehensive as the Puppet Forge or the Chef Supermarket, or I don't know what the YAML or the Ansible one's called. It is not yet that comprehensive, but it is quite large and quite extensive. Any other questions? Yes, here in the front.
This is probably going to be pretty basic, but you're running that state apply manually there. Mm-hmm. That what would normally trigger that? Puppets, we've got it set, you know, 30 minutes or something uptake for new agents.
Yep, that would be on the same thing on the central controller instead of on the edge nodes.
Yep.
You would have the salt, you would have a cron job that just calls state apply every now and then.
Okay, cool.
The second, or the interesting part that I didn't cover at all there is that state apply takes an optional argument. Which I will actually show you right now because it's kind of cool. So it takes an optional argument. What that will do is it will apply the web app state to test one, which we haven't done. We've been treating test one as the Nginx server. So it has just gone off and run the web app state, which was on test two, on test one. So by default, if you run state.apply with nothing, it takes the top file and runs that as is. So in our case, that was that. If you pass it an argument, it will run that particular state on that machine. This gives you the power to not just to have a, what's called the high state like this, which is just the default state of things, but keep in the same repository with all of the same libraries that you've brought into your repository, other things that you might want to do ad hoc, or have different things that run at, on different schedules, right?
Yep.
So, but all of it comes from the central controlling node. That's where the cron jobs would live. That's where the state apply would be run.
Yep. And that asynchronous connection, I imagine, means like you can trigger and apply from the node much easier. I'm thinking much easier than maybe you could do it in Puppet.
You can't really trigger a direct run from the nodes. I mean, you can, and I forget how, but okay. I've always done it from the central server.
Yep.
There are ways to do it on the node as well.
Cool, thanks.
In the back?
What would you do for high availability of the central server?
So there's two. For high availability, there is a feature in Salt called Syndic, which is nested central servers. So you'll have a central server, which can talk down to other central servers, which can talk down from there, which gives you, but as far as like the edge nodes are concerned, there's just one. The other version is, I would have something like, that's the accepted way to do high availability with Salt.
We're about out of time now. Would everyone please thank Aurynn for her tutorial?